subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces burst Pakistan's terror financing module in Jammu and Kashmir. Oppressed ethnic minorities protest against Pak atrocities, observe Black Day on 14th August. And Pakistan-based terror outfits collaborating with African Islamic terror groups to spread violence. Terrorism flourishes with radicalization, strong financial backup and illegal supply of arms. In Kashmir, the terrorists have been surviving with financial and arms supply from neighboring Pakistan. The Pakistani youth, radicalized and trained by Pakistan's army and spy agencies, are sent to Jammu and Kashmir for violent activities. A terror funding module of Pakistan was recently busted in Kashmir by the Indian security forces amid a consistent armed battle between the forces and the terrorists in the valley. Take a look.
Jammu and Kashmir remains a victim of Pakistan-sponsored terrorism since 1947. Be it deadly terror attacks, illegal drugs and manpower supply, or radicalization of Kashmiri youth, Islamabad has not deterred itself from indulging into anti-Indian activities. A country that barely has enough to feed its citizens is busy funding terror groups to carry out violence in India. Recently, Indian intelligence agencies, along with Jammu and Kashmir police, busted at least three separate terrorist financing modules from the Union Territory. As many as nine suspects who were working along with different terrorist outfits in northern districts of Kashmir have been arrested. The arrested people are suspected to be linked to Pakistan in providing funds to the terrorists.
ये तीनों यहाँ पे टेरर फाइनेंसिंग मॉड्यूल जो है चला रहे थे, टेरर एक्टिविटीज़ को फंड करते थे, और इनका एक स्पेसिफिक मॉडस ऑपरेंडी था जिसके तहत ये काम करते थे। ये यहाँ पे जो इनके भाई पाकिस्तान में हैं, उनकी यहाँ ज़मीन बेच के जो है वो पैसा यहाँ पे टेरर एक्टिविटीज़ के लिए यूज़ किया करते थे। उसमें इन तीनों से अभी तक हमने जो है 14 लाख का अकाउंट फोर किया है, जिसमें से 5 लाख की रिकवरी हुई है, और बाकी पैसे इन्होंने अब तक ऐसी दहशतगर्दी की एक्टिविटीज़ को बढ़ावा देने के काम में अंजाम लाए हैं, तो उनका अभी हम तफ्तीश कर रहे हैं।
Despite mounting pressure from terror financing watchdog FATF, Pakistan continues to mobilize funds into Jammu and Kashmir to support terrorist activities. Pakistan's allies and international monetary institutions have been providing financial aid to the country to help it develop its educational and industrial infrastructure, but Islamabad is using those funds to enhance its terror infrastructure.
It was also a world opinion, and all the financial aid which was being given to Pakistan, it was given on this premise that they will stop carrying out the terrorist activities, especially the funding of the terrorist activity. But it seems Pakistan is now not going to listen to this, and India has busted a lot of activities which are being funded, the terrorist activities which are being funded by Pakistan. So this is a very serious matter, and of course the credit goes to the Indian intelligence work, which has unearthed these terrorist activities, especially the route of the financial route coming.
Pakistan is distressed with the elimination of terrorist commanders in Kashmir by the Indian security forces. As part of the all-out operation launched by the Indian Army in Jammu and Kashmir, over 500 Pakistani-sponsored terrorists have been eliminated in last 1.5 years. Recently, the Indian security forces neutralized Hizbul Mujahideen commander Azad Lalhari in an encounter at Kamrazipura in Pulwama district. Experts believe that aggressive anti-terror operation by the security forces in Kashmir Valley is the only solution to counter Pakistan's malicious game in Kashmir.
Pakistan Army and ISI are trying tooth and nail to create chaos in Jammu and Kashmir. You see, the obsession of Pakistan with regard to Kashmir is well known. The obsession is since 1947. And Pakistan has been trying to get into Kashmir anyhow, by terror financing, by creating terror, by winning over loyalty of Muslims in Jammu and Kashmir, by appealing to their religious commitments and religious connection. So the best recourse is that we should get into offensive mode, to put Pakistan in defensive mode, so that Pakistan's total attention is concentrated towards saving its own soil rather than trying to export terror to Jammu and Kashmir.
Since the abrogation of Article 370 last year, the security forces are aggressively working to eliminate the roots of terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir. Pakistan already features in the grey list of Financial Action Task Force, and if it continues to finance terror outfits, the day is not far when it will be blacklisted for its support to terrorism.
And now we talk about state terrorism, which is leading to gross human rights violations within Pakistan and its occupied territories. Except Punjab province, the people in rest of Pakistan and its occupied territories are facing a tough time because of atrocities being committed on them by security agencies and other jihadi groups. We have a report.
These protesters are the family members of thousands of missing persons in Pakistan's Sindh province who were allegedly abducted by the security agencies and are kept in detention centers. They have been protesting and demanding for their release for several months, but the government is sitting like a mute spectator. The protesters clearly shouted, "Ye jo dehshatgardi hai, iske peeche wardi hai." The people in uniform are behind these terrorist activities. The children were holding hoardings saying, "Save Ashkar Brohi, where is my father, and release my father Shahid Junejo."
कम से कम उनको हमसे मिलाया तो जाए अगर उनका कोई कसूर है तो उनको अदालतों में पेश किया जाए तो हम कम से कम उनको देख तो सकें उनसे उनके लिए कोई केस लड़ तो सकें आप ऐसे दहशतगर्दों की तरह हमारे घर में घुसे हैं और हमारे दरवाजे तोड़ के हमारे घरों की जो टूट-फूट की है हमारे घरों में के अंदर जो आपने जो किया है वो हमें सब पता है हम दहशतगर्द जो आप हैं हमें सब पता है
On 14th of August, when Pakistan was celebrating its Independence Day, the Baloch, Pashtun and Sindhis observed it as Black Day. They call Pakistan as an occupier who is using its security forces and jihadi outfits to carry out atrocities on the civilians.
For Baloch people, 14 August is the worst day one of the worst days in human history, just like the days of Holocaust. So the people, especially the Baluch people, and then Sindhis and Pashtuns and Mahajans and Kashmiris, Baltis, Christians, Hindus, everybody there in Pakistan is just like in a prison. Only army is the only one single institution that is free, and that is you can say is celebrating, because they have freedom to kill, freedom to rob, freedom to rape, freedom to convert people, freedom to sell lands, to grab lands in the name of Bharia town and naval and cantonments. They are the free entity. They are the mercenaries. They take dollars. They can fight for anything, for any cause, just that gives dollars to them. So that is their 14th August.
In 1947, Pakistan occupied a part of Jammu and Kashmir with the help of terrorists. Today, called as Pakistan occupied Jammu and Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan, the territory is used as a breeding group of terrorists. Pakistan is providing funds, training and arms to these terror outfits to use them as proxies against India.
हमारे लिए 14 अगस्त योम आज़ादी नहीं, योम सियाह है, और ये सिर्फ हमारे लिए नहीं बल्कि 73 साल तारीख में पहली मर्तबा पाकिस्तान के हर खित्ते, पाकिस्तान के हर सूबे से योम सियाह मनाने की बात गश्त आ रही है। बलोचों ने भी ऐलान किया है कि वो इस मौके पर स्याह झंडे और स्याह पट्टियां बांधेंगे और स्याह झंडे उठाएंगे।
For years, these communities have been enduring the state-backed barbarism. However, people who had come to terms with this inhuman treatment are no more in the mood to live with the status quo. They are out on streets expressing dissent and demanding rights. Islamabad might be playing down the situation in its domestic power corridors, but a rebellion is certainly shaping up among these persecuted ethnic communities.
Hopes for an end to Afghanistan's decades-long conflict appear a shade brighter now, as the Afghan President Ashraf Ghani removed the final hurdle in the way for the beginning of intra-Afghan talks following a peace deal the insurgents signed with the United States this year. The Afghan government has agreed to release the 400 hardcore Taliban prisoners. However, experts believe that peace negotiations with the Taliban will hardly bring down the violent incidents, as there are many other dreaded terrorist groups operating from the soil. A report.
Removing the final stumbling block in the way of peace negotiations between the Afghan government and the Taliban, Afghanistan's Grand Traditional Consultative, the Loya Jirga, approved the release of 400 hardcore Taliban prisoners. The prisoner dispute was the crucial hurdle in launching the intra-Afghan talks between the two warring sides. The Afghan government had already released 4,600 of a promised 5,000 Taliban prisoners, but paused over the remaining 400, who are accused of carrying out some of the country's bloodiest attacks. However, the Taliban refused to endorse the intra-Afghan talks unless the Afghan government released all of its 5,000 prisoners from the jails. Thus, with a hope to clear the way for a peaceful Afghanistan, Ashraf Ghani finally submitted to the complete demands of the Taliban.
در این حال تهدید کرد که اگر اینها رها نشوند، نه تنها به جنگ و خشونت خیش دوام خواهد دادند، بلکه آن را افزایش خواهد داد. دقیق دولاری ما به خاطر دورسازی بار ملامت از گردن جمهوری اسلامی افغانستان، لبک گفتن به ارشادات دینی مبین اسلام و آرزوی سراسری مردم افغانستان گام‌های بزرگ و عملی گذاشته ایم. با آن هم در نقطه رسیده ایم که دوراهی است. شکست این بنبست و انتخاب در این دوراهی بدون مشوره با ملت مصلحت نیست زیرا از ایتی صلاحیت رئیس جمهور بیرون است
The release of these high-level prisoners charged with murder, kidnapping and abduction is being termed controversial and problematic. Among these 400 prisoners are 44 individuals listed in the United States and other countries as a serious security concern for their role in high-profile attacks, over 150 inmates on death row and others accused of playing a role in major attacks against civilians and foreigners. Moreover, the group also includes the members of Haqqani Network, Taliban's lethal military arm, and the Al-Qaeda, which are responsible for carrying out some of the worst terror attacks in the world. In defiance of their commitments not to rejoin the war, a number of Taliban prisoners who were released from the jails have already been reported to be back on the battlefield against the Afghan government.
The Taliban has given a commitment that these fighters will not join into the insurgency. I think the true test of that is going to be declaration of the ceasefire. Once Taliban declares the ceasefire, those who are violating the ceasefire, whether it is split groups from the Taliban or other groups such as the Daesh or the Islamic State of Khorasan as it is known in Afghanistan, Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mujahideen, whose cadres are also fighting there, Haqqani Network, and various other international terrorist groups, they can be then identified and jointly neutralized by the Taliban and the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces.
It's not only the Taliban. There are some 20 terrorist groups in Afghanistan. Some of them have bases in Afghanistan and others in neighboring Pakistan. These prominent terror groups include Haqqani Network, Al-Qaeda, Daesh, Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed and others. Military and experts in Afghanistan believe that extremism and terrorist ideologies originate from Pakistan and are being used as a tool for destroying Afghanistan.
Now, the agreement, the intra-Afghan agreement or the ceasefire, which I am hopeful should come about as soon as possible, will be between the Taliban and the Afghan government. Similarly, the larger agreement is between the United States and the Taliban. Now, there are, as per the Afghan president, Mr. Ashraf Ghani himself, almost 30 plus groups who are operating in Taliban, operating in Afghanistan. Now, point to note is that only Taliban is signing the agreement. There are elements within Taliban who will be splitting and who will not agree to ceasefire. There is the Daesh, there are Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, inducted by the Pakistan Army. There is the groups such as Islamic Mujahideen of Uzbekistan and various other groups which are operating. Those groups have signed no agreement with anybody. Violence by those groups is expected to continue.
Nearly two decades of war with the Taliban have left nothing but scars, sorrow and devastation. The expected intra-Afghan talks have certainly created a sense of optimism about ending this war in Afghanistan. Achieving an acceptable peace agreement, however, looks difficult. It is still uncertain whether the Taliban is serious about reaching a deal with the Afghan government, who they denounce as puppets or have just agreed to them as a ploy to get US forces to leave the country.
It is no hidden fact that Pakistan-supported terror groups are spreading their wings throughout the world. While countries in Asia remains at consistent target of jihadist groups, African continent has now become a new hub of these jihadi outfits as they are collaborating with the local terrorist organizations to not only indulge in terror-related activities but are jointly carrying out human trafficking, drug smuggling and other illegal activities. The involvement of Pakistani missions in African countries is also exposed. A report.
A Pakistani diplomat was recently deported from South Africa for flouting multiple local and international laws related to illegal human trafficking. Waqas Ahmed, who was employed in the Pakistan embassy in Harare, was intercepted in 2019 for helping three Pakistani nationals to illegally enter into South Africa through Bait Bridge. The incident is one out of several others where Pakistan's diplomatic missions has been found complicit in activities like human trafficking and drug smuggling. According to a report published in the Standard newspaper in May this year, a businessman settled in Zimbabwe had also accused Harare-based Pakistan embassy staffers of running a human trafficking racket to smuggle nationals into South Africa. Terrorism, money laundering, drug trafficking and human trafficking in the African continent have risen in recent years. Experts believe that terrorist organizations like Al-Qaeda and Hizbul Mujahideen are expanding their reach and collaborating with Africa-based terror outfits.
The Sahel region is a big, vast region where you have a concentration of different movements, terrorists, jihadists. They have alliance with Pakistani organization and Afghan as well, and to reinforce their network and destabilize African state.
Al-Qaeda and Islamic State-affiliated organizations Jamaat Nusrat al-Islam wal-Muslimin and Islamic State in Greater Sahara are predominantly operating in triangle of the three countries in South Africa. The Lake Chad Basin is dominated by infamous Boko Haram, which is listed as one of the four most violent radical Islamic terror groups in the world. Boko Haram has been shifting loyalties with the international terrorist outfits mainly settled in and around Pakistan. In 2009, it aligned with the Al-Qaeda to fulfill its political ambitions, but later forced an alliance with ISIS in 2015 to reconstitute itself as Islamic State West Africa Province. Since then, Pakistan-sponsored terrorist training camps have been found running in African regions like Dao.
Boko Haram is a jihadist organization that is a nebula of drug traffickers. It's officially joined ISIS in 2015. After the occupation of northern Mali in March 2012, we saw the presence of Pakistani and Afghan trainers in the terrorist training camp in Gao and Mopti as well.
Pakistan has been establishing its diplomatic relations and missions in the African continent at an accelerated pace since 2019. Meanwhile, radical jihadi violence associated with Pakistan is increasing all through Africa and spreading to international locations which aren't overwhelmingly Muslim dominated.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreyasa Vijay, signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.